Hi, everybody. I'm Chris Primesberger, editor-in-chief of eWeek.com. Thanks for joining us today for another segment of eWeek eSpeaks. This is a series of IT conversations with thought leaders from every corner of the business. Our interviewee today is AB Parayasamy, and AB is the CEO and co-founder of Min.io, is that how it's pronounced?
That's right.
It looks like Min.io. I want to be sure it's not Minio. That's why I said that. So anyway, welcome to eSpeaks.
Thank you for having me on your show, Chris.
And I love finding out about storage-related companies and open source-related companies because that's kind of my background. Tell me a little bit about yourself, AB, and the genesis of the company.
My background, I've been in the open source storage particularly. It's kind of a trap you fall into it. You can't easily get out. And distributed systems, basically a software engineer and try to find simple solutions to complex problems. And this startup Min.io is about object storage. And the reason why we came into Min.io was not about building an object storage. Like previously we built a Gluster file system. People think that this is a continuation of that startup, but actually the reason why we did Min.io was because I asked for a simple problem that will live for next 10 years and compound and grow. And it turned out to be data growth. And when you do a startup, you pick a problem that's not a short-term trend. And because pivots are really dangerous for startups, right? So I was looking for pretty much any problem. My other choice, people won't believe, was actually Bionics. And we put that aside, look for a simple problem that we could touch across the world and build a powerful brand. And it turned out to be just explosive data growth. And Amazon kind of nailed the infrastructure when it comes to how a modern data infrastructure should look like. And it was reduced to just simple RESTful APIs as an object storage. And you turn around and see, one thing I knew about this market was this is a very complicated piece of software and hardware that for ages they've only done incremental improvements, and it was calling for a total reset, and Amazon hit the reset button. But my point was, if Amazon succeeds with AWS S3, it will be a winner inside AWS. What about outside AWS, which is where bulk of the market is? And my point was, if we build something better than Amazon S3 as a software, open source software, give it to everyone, we can't go wrong. And we can go after a bigger market than Amazon S3. And that's how Min.io was created.
Well, that's a lofty ambition for sure.
It is.
Maybe, yeah. That's great stuff. Just a few housekeeping things here. How long has the company been in business?
We incorporated in November of 2014, really 2015, we started hacking on the project.
Okay, so you've got real customers. You're not just in beta, you're not just testing, you're selling it by now, right?
Oh, absolutely. In fact, we focused on the land grab first, because this is a market, like you said, it's a lofty ambition, right? And the problem in this market is, if you are small, no one wants to put their data in something that's unproven. You have to show it at a grand scale, and it's kind of a winner take all market. So we focused on establishing a large footprint across the world. In the first 5 years, it just grew so fast. It's continuing to accelerate on top of that. It's like almost like, actually it's now 700,000 plus Docker pulls a day. We are now the leading in our category. When it comes to hybrid cloud storage, pretty much we are by far the largest. Even the bigger players in our space, if you put them together, they are still way behind us. When it comes to the business side, for us, we always knew that if customers put their most sensitive business critical data on us, and if it grows and it goes into production, they're not going anywhere. And we waited for that moment. So last year, it was around August, we opened the subscription network, and it's a flood of customers coming in. And now it's actually growing really fast. In a very short time, it's now close to 100 customers. So now our next path is getting to 1,000 customers in just next couple of years.
Wow, good for you. So do you have a freemium model, AB, or what?
For me, business is actually about, like, if I if I solve the problem for you, and if it's worth, right, you give me $5 and I give you $50 worth of value, but it cost me $2 to make it, it's as simple as that, right? So there is some economics established. There should be no dancing around. It has to be very clear what I give to you and what you give to me. I didn't like the freemium model, the open core model. It's a bait model that, for me, it builds a poor brand, right? It's better to keep it plain and simple and show that what I'm solving for them. So instead of creating this open core type model, even proprietary model is fine. I just did not like the open core model or a premium model that up to this much it's free, beyond that you pay me, and you kind of mislead them, right? Instead, what I did, kept everything exactly the same. A community guy and a customer actually gets the same software bits. And why do you pay? You pay because if you are building a commercial proprietary software, you can't open source your software because it's under AGPL license, and you can buy a commercial license, right? It's a dual licensing model. And then you also don't want to lose data, or you don't want to have a data breach. So basically these three reasons are simple enough for them to pay, see the value.
Yeah, thanks for explaining that, because that hasn't been explained that way to me before. And I've been covering open source for a long time. So that's a good one. And you see, 2014, you got going on this. That was an early bet on Kubernetes, wasn't it?
It was actually, you know, it looks that way from outside, right? Yeah. I have to thank our community for that. We always gravitated towards, let's keep it simple. There should be only one way to do one thing. Our biggest strength is keeping it simple so we can solve complex problems. The ideology behind the project was find a simple solution to a complex problem. Everything worked great. And then you start listening to the signals in the market. Kubernetes was our Docker was not how we planned for everything. We planned something that was modern cloud native. In today we call it cloud native, but when we started, it was naturally our design. But what happened was the community started containerizing their applications first. Once they containerized their application, they were like, I don't want MinIO or Elastic or Redis, those dependent components that held the state to actually be on the bare metal. They wanted to containerize the whole stack because they got the benefit of containerization by rolling out their entire software dependency free, right? Everything was just rolled out as containers on any environment. They naturally pulled in Kubernetes to orchestrate. Before Kubernetes, we saw basically Docker Swarm, Compose, Mesos, like Cloud Foundry, like Open Service Broker, a whole bunch of these industry converged. We were simply listening to the signals of the market. We were naturally in each of these areas, and Kubernetes became the winner.
Okay, good. Another housekeeping question here. Mm-hmm. How does it work? Is it strictly a software as a service, or is it a software that can be run in a server in a private cloud, or both?
It is strictly a piece of software that you just download. You mm-hmm. can download to your laptop, even Raspberry Pi. We have seen like 5G towers and some autonomous cars driving inside it. Or you can download it into your private cloud environment, like typically Kubernetes. We also see now Kubernetes is part of VMware as well. So it runs in VMware. And the same software gets downloaded inside the public cloud, whether it's AWS or Google Cloud, pretty much all the popular clouds, MinIO is there. Even inside AWS, there is more than 3 million unique IPs of MinIO running there. It's basically a software you can download and run anywhere. As long as you have a set of machines, some network and drives attached to it, you can turn them into a distributed high-performance object storage.
Yeah, choice is good, it's never bad. You give the user plenty of choices. Tell me about subnet health. What is it, and how is MinIO connected to that? What problem do you solve there?
So subnet health, it was really created to solve our problem. It's specifically people inside MinIO. Anything we do, we have to solve it at a grand scale because the problem we took was that a bigger problem. And if you do it small, we fail. And for us, the most important thing today is the value is not in the software. Software is a baggage, right? The more code we add, the more bugs we add, and then someone has to maintain it. Finding bugs, fixing bugs are way more painful than creating it, right? When you make new releases, what we wanted to make sure was, as customers put us in production, the real value is how do you operate that infrastructure with very little skills and no downtime or no data breach. It's the theory, right? Now you can minimize it to a point where it's almost insignificant and it's very profitable, meaning very efficient to run the infrastructure. Now, if you see, bulk of the cost is actually the people cost and finding what went wrong, and fixing is even easier, right? So Subnet Health was basically instrumentation that brought into the Minaivo software itself. And then our side, when you run this diagnostics, it's a multi-point inspection that it performs all kinds of network drive, every component in the system. And it's like onboard OBD2 port in your car that you can do diagnostics. It runs these diagnostics so we can quickly tell. In fact, we, meaning Subnet Health, is basically an automated piece of software for support. It would immediately tell what's wrong in your system. It could be Minaivo problem or it could be your infrastructure problem. If I can tell you the root cause of those set of specific drives, or the new batch of drives are actually 30% slower than the rest of the drives. That's why you're seeing timeout at a high performance, like when you push the limit. These are hard to find problems, right? Subnet Health is basically turning all those support problems into an automated software problem.
Okay. We have just a couple minutes left, AB. Mm-hmm. Can you just give me a quick example, illustration of a use case, a favorite use case of yours? And then if you could just outline the news that was announced mm-hmm. last week, that would be good.
Sure. Yeah, object storage is a horizontal play. It's like all the way from AIML data pipelines to autonomous driving to some web applications. It's exactly like S3. It touches pretty much every industry. And in terms of the news that came out recently, it was basically all about how to increase efficiency when it comes to operations, right? Like ability to do faster support, ability to scale, all like from the customer side, I don't want you to require hiring Amazon skilled engineers, right? I want you to be able to operate not knowing how to spell Kubernetes. So all of that with a nice fancy UI and with the remote support, automated support, you can actually run a large scale infrastructure with very little skills. That was basically the news.
All right, AB Periasamy, CEO and co-founder of Min.io. And if we were to look for you online, would it be min.io or would it be min.io.com or what? What's the website?
It is min.io.
I figured you couldn't resist that. That's a good one. That's a natural one.
Yeah.
AB, thanks a lot for joining us on eSpeaks today. I appreciate you explaining the company and a little about your background.
Thank you, Chris. It was wonderful being on your show.
Okay. And as we wrap it up today, thank you very much for heading all the way to the end with us. Have a great rest of your eWeek.
Thanks for joining us on eWeek eSpeaks. Go to eWeek.com to hear more conversations with IT thought leaders.